Thank you all for coming. And I'm going to begin my talk. And I want to give a little background about what I'm doing and why I'm doing it. I'm a docent at the Rubin Museum in New York. And as you can imagine, museums across the country, across the world are really suffering. So we docents don't have a lot to do. And I have been leading a Dharma study group with many of the docents, some of whom are practitioners and some of whom aren't. All of them are quite interested in the Dharma, but they don't necessarily have that much meditation experience. And what I found is in presenting the Dharma, as wonderful it is, as it is, it can be very abstract. You do the Four Noble Truths, the Eightfold Path, the 12 Links of Dependent Origination, and sometimes it can be very hard to see how it relates to your life. So what I started doing was presenting poems that would reinforce the teachings. And I found out that it worked quite well. And in doing that, I started to see how poems and the Dharma work well together. And much to my pleasant surprise, I was looking at a paper about the Ming Dynasty Chan master, Hanshan Deqing, and found that he wrote a collection of mind poems, and he had a lot to say about poetic theory. And one of the things that he declared was that poetry is Chan. And he actually had a method where he would use a poem and start to visualize it as actually being real, and then look at reality in front of him and imagine it was a poem. So there was this kind of an exchange. And there is much in the teaching of the Dharma where we're enjoined to look at the world as if it's a dream. And of course, that doesn't mean we're supposed to believe it's a dream. It's a way of loosening our attachments to the concepts that we are continually creating. So I saw there was a lot that could be understood and a lot that could be conveyed using poetry. Additionally, I came across a Russian critic named Shklovsky, who in establishing his theories of poetry came up with this word called defamiliarization, meaning that when you read the poetry of a great poet, you become defamiliarized with what you normally experience. And this to me seems very dharmically sound, because what the Chan teaching is all about is to show us how we walk around, often conveyed, not just impelled, not just by karma, but by our habitual tendencies, our conditioning, the patterns that we have established in our minds. We don't know it. And we're enjoined to turn the light around and watch, see how our minds react, see what's going on, and to take a step back and not necessarily react the way that we normally do, learn how to respond out of an understanding and an experience of wisdom. And so poets, some of the great poets, are masters of exploring their feelings, their minds. Another thing that Hanshan Deqing said is that many people think that in Chan, we discard emotions. They're the kind of things that we that break our dispassion, that cause attachment. And he said, on the contrary, you look deeply into how these things work. And then he said that the patriarchs and the Buddhas are yesterday's dreams. You know, what we have is what we're encountering right now. And anything that will show that to us is very helpful. And so what I'd like to do is then launch into looking at the poems and showing what I mean, rather than just continuing in theory. So now, Sarah. Hi. So here's the thing. So I'm starting to. Sorry. Thank you. We're looking at expressing ourselves using words. Now, interestingly enough, one of the main teachings of Chan goes back to Bodhidharma, who talked about a teaching that is beyond words, outside of the scriptures, that points to the mind and reveals the nature. So you would think that if you're dealing with words and concepts, you're putting obstacles in your own path. But it's not necessarily so. And as we go through this, you'll be able to judge for yourself. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to continue going over a number of poems, 20 minutes to half an hour, and then I'll open up for discussion. And then we can go in many different directions. But I want to start by this quote from Byron, from Don Juan. It's actually pronounced Don Juan in English literature. But words are things, and a small drop of ink falling like dew upon a thought produces that which makes thousands, perhaps millions, think. And then he goes on to say, 'tis strange the shortest letter which man uses instead of speech may form a lasting link of ages to what straits old time reduces frail man, when paper, even a rag like this, survives himself, his tomb, and all that's his. So that to me sounds almost like the sutras, that they transcend time, they transcend space, that they are just words. But as it says in the Diamond Sutra, Buddhas and Bodhisattvas come out of the sutra. So the concept itself, what's behind the concept, might be an illusion. And of course, there's a Zen saying that as soon as you open your mouth, everything you say is wrong. But as the scholar John Donne says, that it may be wrong, but you can say something useful. And that's what I'm going to try to do. And also, here is from a very famous poem by Sengsang, Faith in Mind. This is just one stanza. So if you wish to move in the one way, do not even dislike the world of senses and ideas. Indeed, to accept them fully is identical to enlightenment. And one other thing I want to add in giving this talk, you know, one of the things that we deal with is attachments and finding out what assumptions that we have that we don't know that we have. And so when I started giving a talk on Western poetry, part of me said, well, wait a second, that's not real Dharma. That's not a sutra. That's not the Abhidharma. That's not the Chan patriarchs that I'll be talking about. And then I thought about it and I thought, well, most of us, I mean, if we're not in a monastery, what our lives are is everyday life, common things, having families, going to work, eating, running, finding out about the world, just normal things. And that's what poetry is about. And that is really, that's the path. Our lives as they are evolving are really the path. And whereas the true Chan teachings really can straighten us out, there's much to be learned here. So, go to the next poem, please. Now, I picked this poem by Walt Whitman because its emotional content is next to zero, right? It is, and this is once again why I did the meditation the way that I did. I mean, normally you wouldn't meditate in that manner, going through the five skandhas, but I was making a point of how everything is put together, and how we tend not to notice it. We tend to live just in our minds. But here's a poem, very straightforward, called The Runner. On a flat road runs the well-trained runner. He is lean and sinewy with muscular legs. He is thinly clothed. He leans forward as he runs with lightly closed fists and arms partially raised. So what Whitman has done with words is to take a photograph. And there's nothing here but words. But when you look at it, and because of your understanding of language and your experience, what you see here can come alive. You can see the well-trained runner. You can almost feel how the wind is passing by his body as he's leaning forward. The only word that we have, there are only two words in the poem that have to do with motion, running and leaning. And of course, they're just words. There's nothing going on in the poem until we make it happen. And so here's an example of how we can see how our minds take concepts and ideas, and we can put them together. And probably, if you examine how you react to the poem, you can have some kind of an emotional reaction. You can imagine that this man is very well put together, handsome. He may be someone that might generate a certain amount of admiration or envy. It might remind you that you have to exercise, or that you would like to exercise, or you know people who are runners. So from just these flat words on the page that were written well over 100 years ago, written in the 19th century. At this moment, there is something that actually comes alive for us. And how our perception, which is how I labeled this whole section, can turn into volition. It's part of our consciousness, part of our memory, all of these things put together, and all of a sudden we take this and we, no pun intended, or maybe a pun intended, we run with it. And when you look at a poem like this, you can see how your mind works, whereas when you're in your everyday life, you're drinking coffee, you're talking to a friend, your mind might run off by itself and you might not notice. Here, by seeing something on a page, having distance from it, you can have a new perspective. You can start to get some idea, a little inkling of how your mind works. And remember, it was either Baudelaire or Mallarmé who was so into his poetry that he believed that poetry actually had a smell to it. Just the words, just listening to the words. That's how sensitized one can be to this kind of language. So let's go to the next poem, please. All right, so now notice the label, fake news or upaya, meaning skillful means. And I picked this because I thought it's very relevant. And this is a very short sutta from the Pali Canon, the Nikayas. And I'll read it because it's not that long. And so the Buddha, it says, on one occasion, the Buddha was staying with a group of disciples in a Simsapa forest in Kosambi. He reached down, picking up a handful of leaves. He then asked those gathered, "What is greater in number, the leaves in my hand or those in the trees?" The disciples replied, The leaves in your hand are few, and the trees have many more. Just as the leaves in the trees are more numerous, the things that I know from direct knowledge are far more numerous than what I teach as my Dhamma. The reason I do not teach these other things is that they are not part of my Dhamma. They are not related to my Dharma, and they do not support the principles of life integrated with the Eightfold Path. And these other things do not lead to disenchantment, to dispassion, to calm, to direct knowledge, to cessation, or to self-awakening. These other things do not lead to unbinding. So what the Buddha is telling us that there's only so much that he can impart. You know, and it's kind of an interesting, today's December 7th, and this is actually the eve of Rohatsu. And Rohatsu, and in Chinese it's Laba, this is the night when the Buddha attained full enlightenment. And on the first watch, he saw all his past lives. The second watch, he understood the workings of karma. And on the third watch, he actually began his teachings. He had the vision, the understanding of the Four Noble Truths and the Eight Path, the Eightfold Path. And this, of course, what we're studying here is Mahayana. So the teachings have, it's very, very delicate to say this, they've either moved on from what he first announced, what he first enunciated, or they have blossomed. But the message changed somewhat in later teachings. And here, this is kind of a presage of this. The Buddha is telling us that there are only certain things that we really can know. He knows there's nothing that the Buddha doesn't know, but what we can know is limited. And of course, Merleau-Ponty, the fourth, the 20th century French philosopher said, we're always acting on more information than we actually have. And the Buddha understood this well and made sure that we really cherished what we were hearing and we understood the purpose. It was not for intellectual enrichment. No, it was to end suffering. That is what the Buddha and all of his teachings are about, ending suffering. So in order to do that, in order to listen to his message, we have to do this wisely. So if you go to the next poem, right here, yeah. So this is Emily Dickinson's, this is 19th century. And so this is interesting to compare with the Buddhist Sutta that I just read. And Dickinson didn't really title her poems, so I'll just read it. Tell all the truth, but tell it slant. Success in circuit lies, too bright for our infirm delight, the truth's superb surprise. As lightning to the children eased with explanation kind, the truth must dazzle gradually, or every man be blind. So to my mind, this is kind of a poem that at its heart has a kind of non-dualistic message. There is a truth out there, and it is a truth that can be understood, but how you understand it, how much you understand, to what degree, to how close you keep to the message, that's something that you really have to pay attention to. And when you are teaching or talking to someone or imparting knowledge, you have to be very aware of where that person is, what they can understand, how the message may help or harm them. So this is a very, very wonderful poem and a very important message. And you can see how if you just looked at it as a Western poem, well, it's a nice poem. I mean, it's a wonderful poem. But once again, when it's matched with a Buddhist sutta like this, I think it takes on perhaps a deeper meaning. So let's move now to the next poem. Now we're going to go a little bit deeper, and now we're going to go into kind of the depths of our understanding of our emotions. So this poem also is not titled, by William Butler Yeats, also towards the end of the 19th century, early 20th century. A pity beyond all telling is hid in the heart of love. The folk who are buying and selling, the clouds on their journey above, the cold, wet winds ever blowing, and the shadowy hazel grove where mouse gray waters are flowing, threaten the head that I love. Now, there is a lot in this poem, quite a bit. And let's look, first of all, at pity. Now, pity is quite interesting, because pity can be altruistic in a way, but pity can also be arrogant, can be something where you are showing your superiority or your believed superiority towards another person. And I believe that the pity in this poem is within Yeats, and because of what he's recognizing. And one of the things that we do in Chan meditation is we open ourselves up. We look inside to see what's going on. Oftentimes, we don't like it. We don't like what we see. It's painful. But he is letting us in. And when he says, beyond all telling, here is one of the greatest poets of the 20th century. It's not because he's at a loss for words. This is where words end. It cannot be expressed. And not only cannot it be expressed, it's not that easy to perceive, right? Because it's hid in the heart of love. And I imagine just in that word hidden, one could have many Dharma lectures. What's hidden? How is it hidden? What is it actually doing that we're not aware of? How do we even know that it's hid? There's so many ways that you can approach this. And once again, it's not hid in love, it's hid in the heart of love. And what is the difference between love and the heart of love? It's something that asks us to look much, much deeper. Also, and if you look at going back to pity, so in the Bible, it says, like a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear them. But in the Lotus Sutra, bodhisattvas are described as those who hope to win final nirvana for all beings, for the sake of the many, for their weal and happiness, out of pity for the world. So here is this expansive pity. This it's maybe not the word that we would always use, but you can see how where the Lotus Sutra is going with this. This is looking at all the truth that Emily Dickinson was talking about, that bodhisattvas, especially as they rise in their practice, become more and more aware of, and they develop the means and the wisdoms to help sentient beings. But here we are in this poem with a poet who is suffering, right? And you can see the connectedness of his suffering. It's not just the nature of love, but it's the way it's connected to the whole world. The folk who are buying and selling, well, that's the whole world of economics. That's people's livelihood. That's people coming and going, talking to one another, building businesses, being successful, failing. And that's the whole human world. And then even the clouds on their journey above, there's something menacing going on. And then the cold, wet winds ever blowing. This is what he's sensitive to, given the mood that he's in. And the shadowy hazel grove, something menacing, something threatening, as we see at the end of the poem. Mouse gray waters are flowing. He's not appreciating the beautiful liver, the beautiful river, the glistening waters, the lovely impermanence, the beautiful sound of the river. No, it's mouse gray. It's as constricted and perhaps unpleasant as you could possibly imagine. All of those things coming together, threaten the head that I love. So this poem is teetering, and it's filled with impermanence, with all of the things that can happen. Even though what's so interesting is that he's in love and perhaps enjoying the love, but he's aware of dukkha. One of the many translations of dukkha is uncertainty. We never know what's going to happen from one minute to the next. And here you can see how Yeats has laid this out in very few lines, but has opened up a whole cornucopia of ways that we can suffer, all the kinds of ways that we can attach to things. But he is looking at it. He's looking at it, and he's not taking his eyes off it. And he really looks at it deeply and says, this is a pity beyond all telling. So now we've opened up the mainstream of what Buddhist practice is about. It's about suffering, dukkha, uncertainty, impermanence, all fomenting and bubbling in this poem. So let's go to the next poem. Okay, so now I'm going to move to a perhaps more cerebral look at the practice, but I'm going to look at this poem by Wallace Stevens, also one of the great poets of the 20th century. And I'm going to read the poem, and then I'm going to go through it. Because the poem, once again, I found once I brought a kind of dharmic look to it, a dharmic way of observing it, then it started to make sense. but before that, it was a little baffling. So this is The Snowman. One must have a mind of winter to regard the frost and the boughs of the pine trees crusted with snow, and have been cold a long time to behold the junipers shagged with ice, the spruces rough in the distant glitter of the January sun, and not to think of any misery in the sound of the wind, in the sound of a few leaves, which is the sound of the land full of the same wind that is blowing in the same bare place for the listener who listens in the snow, and nothing himself beholds nothing that is not there, and the nothing that is. So if we look at this, let's just take the first thing in the poem of a mind. Now, in the Satipatthana Sutra, which is the foundational sutra for mindfulness, it talks about four foundations of mindfulness. And we, in a sense, touched on that in our meditation with looking at the body and sensations and the mind and consciousness and our perceptions. But so the first of the four foundations of the Satipatthana Sutra is the body, concentration, awareness of the body as the body and nothing but the body. And then it's about sensations that arise that have feelings of pleasantness, unpleasantness, and neutrality. But then the third of the foundations of mindfulness is the mind. And that means states of mind, mood, could be anger, could be love, could be pity, could be dispassion, could be a number of things. But the mind that we have, our mood, frames the world for us. We look out in many ways through how our mind is configured, what we are becoming aware of, what we're ignoring. That is how our ordinary minds work, not the true mind of awareness. But here we are in the world of poetry, and we're looking at our ordinary vexed minds. So now, if you have a mind of winter, that means your mind is at one with winter, with everything about winter. So as you regard the frost and the boughs and the pine trees and the cold and the junipers shagged with ice and spruces rough in the distant glitter, right? Your mind is at one with the winter scene. So you are not in a desirous mode. You're not in a rejecting mode. You have the mind of winter, and that is how you are perceiving the world. And with the title of The Snowman, Stevens is talking about a kind of isolation and a way that we engage with our perception, seeing how we are making of the world what it is by our own manipulations, our own machinations. So given if you are in that state, you don't have to think of the misery in the sound of the wind or in the sound of the few leaves, and then expand that to the sound of the land full of the same wind that is blowing in the same bare place. Now, it's interesting in this poem, in one way he's transcended emotion, but on the other hand, he's the poet. So he knows about misery, and he knows about this the sad sound of the bareness of the place. So there is a kind of dispassion and passion all happening at once, and then so the poet, the snowman, is the listener, is in the midst of this of the scene, encountering it. Listening in the snow, but because he is listening and he is nothing but listening, which actually it's interesting, I was reading in the Shirangama Sutra about Avalokiteshvara's method of achieving enlightenment was through listening. Right? So he's listening in the snow. So he's become nothing himself. There's nothing to him. And so he beholds nothing that is not there. He has a perfect awareness, right? There is nothing in his mind. There's no attachment that would obfuscate the world to him. So he is seeing everything there. So he's seeing nothing that is not there. And now the last one is this last phrase is where I have to turn Stevens into a Buddhist, right? He could have said the emptiness, right? But it's probably better that he didn't, but if you understand this as emptiness, then what he's perceiving, even the stuff that he sees clearly, he's not labeling it. He's not he's still managing to keep his dispassion. He is isolated as a snowman. Now, this is not a poem of enlightenment. Stevens was a pretty crusty guy, drank a lot, but his abilities of perception, his understanding of the mind was phenomenal. And let me go and sort of work another, here's another poem of his. The Tea at the Palace of Hun. Now, just to give you a little background, there is no such place or building or anything called Hun. He made this up. And he just came up with a funny spelling of palaz to give it a kind of mystique, right? Now, even if it said the Palace of Buckingham or the Palace of Versailles, we as the readers, unless we happen to live in Buckingham or Versailles, wouldn't, you know, we'd have a reference point, but we wouldn't know that much. And then there is, this poem has a dreamlike quality. There's a man descending kind of steps, coming into his into a palace. And there's some idea that he's royalty. And it's kind of like he's waking up and we, the reader, we are waking up as we accompany him. So he says, not less because in purple I descended the western day through what you called the loneliest air, not less was I myself. So he has a sense of himself as he's waking up, right? But then he starts to become aware of his environment, right? Now, in a very different way from the earlier poem. And he's aware of his body, he's aware of the environment. The ointment sprinkled on my beard. So that's a sense of royalty in ancient Greece and Rome would often put fragrant ointments on their bodies and their clothing. You know, it was a sign of status. And he's hearing hymns. Perhaps they're part of a ceremony that he may partake in. We don't know. And he doesn't recognize them, but he recognizes that they're hymns. So there's a slow awakening. And he's feeling the sea, because he's perceiving it, he's feeling it actually sweep right through him. So the actual, the integrity of his body is kind of in question here. And then the golden ointment is raining out of his mind. So what physicality can it have now if the ointment is raising, is emanating out of his mind? So the senses and consciousness are being merged together here. And my ears made the blowing hymns they heard. So he's recognizing this fabrication happening right in his senses. And I was myself the compass of that sea. So there's this growing awareness of how he is encountering the world and himself. And so then he says, I was the world in which I walked. And what I saw or heard or felt came not but from myself. And there I found myself more truly and more strange. So there's a kind of dawning, a kind of awakening. Once again, not necessarily a Chan awakening, but a turning of the light inward. So let's see how we're doing for time. What I'd like to do now is just open it up for a little while, see if anyone has any comments or questions. I have a lot of other material, but, please.
Jenna. Can't hear you.
Harry, hi. This is Rick in New York.
Oh, sorry, my name's Jenna Beth. I was being called.
Okay,
up.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead, Jenna.
Yes,
yeah, Rick, you'll be next.
There was just confusion on the muting, unmuting. thank you for giving us this opportunity to look into the poetry this way. I had a question about something I heard you say a few times about how this is not a Chan awakening, or this is not enlightenment. And I wonder why you're hesitant to allow it to be something like that.
All right, well, it's interesting that you say that. I personally am very careful when I talk about what is or isn't a Chan awakening. I'm not an authority on that, believe me. And so I've had times, I remember being with Master Sheng Yan and showing him a poem by Wang Wei where the poet sort of disappears. It seemed very impressive to me. Master Sheng Yan said, you know, I don't see real awakening in this poem. You know, it just, you know, so I, what I'm more certain about is what's actually going on in the poem as I understand it, that someone is opening themselves up to experience in a certain way. But a real Chan awakening is where one has perfected wisdom and compassion, and where the sense of self, of any holding on to self, has really been transcended. You can use yourself in many ways, but that's it's no longer binding you to what you think the world is. And I just personally couldn't presume to, you know, once again, maybe Yeats or Wallace Stevens were totally enlightenment, totally enlightened. I don't know. So I'm just hedging my bet. So that's why I said it the way that I did.
Thank you. Makes sense.
Yes.
Yeah, hi, it's Rick.
Yeah.
So I really enjoyed the poetry you selected, and you know, gave your exegesis, your analysis of, and your connection to Buddhism. I thought it's terrific and brings back many memories because I've known you a long time. But my question is about the Samyutta Nikaya, the leaves story that you showed us. And at the end of that, oh, you didn't comment on it, but at the bottom, there's the translation of the Four Noble Truths.
Right.
And in English, I was expecting the word suffering, and I saw in that translation, stress. So I'm interested in that because you know that I have been dealing with a lot of that in recent months. So for various angles and not COVID related, we all have that, it's different. But can you comment a little bit more about that? Did sure, that strike I, you I, as unusual or normal, a normal translation or what?
Yeah, well, all right. So once again, when I went through the because I have, there's a lot of material and I wanted to get through it. I mean, I didn't read the whole sutta. I just sort of got what I wanted to say, but you're right. All right. So this, you're asking a classic question. The word in Sanskrit is dukkha. In Chinese, it's ku, right? For bitterness.
Mm-hmm. Ku.
And so it's dukkha is actually in some ways it's considered to not be translatable because it's so all-encompassing, like in that Yeats poem, so many things connected to it. But I've seen this enough times to have some faith in this a kind of etymology of it, which is that du means bad and ka is the hole in a chariot wheel, and so it's a bad hole. And so the axle is going, you're not getting a smooth ride, right? So and because of that, and this is all, you know, that's the first noble truth of suffering. The second noble truth explains all of the ways that suffering manifests to us. And it's multi-determined. And so there's, there's stress, there's dissatisfaction, there's disappointment, all these kind of things where your mood has been thrown off. And it's not just negative things, even if when you're in states of pleasure, of happiness, right? When you hold on to them, that causes suffering because of impermanence. Impermanence is never ending. There's nothing impermanent about impermanence, right? So the real key and the real cause of suffering is attachment. It's not that it's not pain itself. It's not disappointment itself. It's not that if you engage on in a project and it fails miserably, that in and of itself is not suffering, but it's your reaction to it. And that's what makes it so elusive and so difficult to understand, because we're continually kind of sizing up the world and we have a narrative going on. I mean, that's sort of what our sense of self is and our ego. It's a narrative. And that narrative, we continually try to tweak it and change it. And we're in denial and in expectation. And we're sort of, our mind is going out and our mind is constricting. And so reality is kind of going like this, if you will, right? In a steady, and our minds are going like this. So this is what suffering is, our distractedness. But it's a good question.
Thank you.
Sure. I want to see anyone else.
Lily.
Okay, so I have.
I have a little question about the Yeats poem.
Okay. And
what it is that, like, he was a consummate fisherman, a fly fisherman, and in many ways he absolutely loved the cold water, and so a sense of that gray cold, like the gray Connemara man. It's very difficult because poetry speaks to different people at a different level, and his poetry is very much where the beauty that he sees, it's like walking on a rainy day where there's cold, and where no matter what, there's always a bit of suffering and the misery, but the cold is something that's an element in the gray, and the water is an element that he was really in love with and almost one with, wouldn't you say?
Well, now this is an interesting thing. This is, in literary criticism, there's always this issue of bringing the author in and equating something about the author with something that the author has created. Now, once again, what you're saying may be perfectly valid, but he also may, as a poet, as putting himself into a particular frame of mind and being true to that frame of mind, that may have made those mousy waters very unpleasant. Now, and to you as the reader, you may be a fly fisherman, or you may be someone who loves water like that. That may be a very pleasant image. For someone else, it may be unpleasant. This is what's also so wonderful about poetry, is what we bring to it and what it brings out of us. You know, when we look at this stuff, we start to express things and find out things about ourselves that we might never have known. So now I can continue with a few more poems, if they're, we still, I think, have some time. Okay. So this is interesting. So what I want to go to here is this, is the sense of self, right? Very, very important teaching concept, thing to look into in Chan practice, right? Because remember when I was asked that question about Chan enlightenment, and I talked about transcending the self. The self, even knowing that you have a self in a certain way, is quite an undertaking, right? It's you know, if somebody takes your place, you know, in a theater, you have an assigned seat and they're in your seat, well, you're very aware of yourself. You know that they're where you should be. But other times when you're talking to someone, making an opinion, criticizing a movie or something like that, you may not be so aware of how there's a tendentiousness to your own identity. So here's this poem by Cosmolite. So Georgia Douglas Johnson was a Black woman poet in the Harlem Renaissance. She's talking about, you know, being a cosmopolite. And maybe there's polite in that, a citizen of the world. And not wholly this or that, but wrought of alien bloods am I, a product of the interplay of traveled hearts. Estranged, yet not estranged, I stand, all comprehending from my estate, I view Earth's frail dilemma. Scion of fused strength am I, all understanding, nor this nor that contains me. So once again, I can't, I cannot tell what her level of attainment is, you know, from a Chan perspective. I think it would be a silly place to go. But what you can see is how expansive her vision is, how she's aware now of, once again, of Chan teachings, of causes and conditions. How causes and conditions never fail. Everything is composed of something and something else. That's why when we meditate, when we practice Chan, and we're looking for our self nature, we're looking at a self nature that is not composite, which is we call it uncreated, unborn, unarising. But everything that we encounter in life, you know, the buildings that we live in, our bodies, the books that we read, the print in the books, the sky, the earth, the planets, they've all coalesced. They're all made of other things, you know, scientifically put, atoms and molecules. So she's realizing that she is a product of, you know, different people, of alien bloods from time immemorial, composed of all sentient beings that have come before by extension, and a product of the interplay of traveled hearts, not just of the physicality of people, but of their experience, right? So that mind and body is here. And once again, I'm assuming, you know, given the difficulties of being a Black woman in America, estranged, but not, she's not consumed by that, yet not estranged. She's looking at everything. She's in a kind of equanimous, non-judgmental state, right? She's not going to give us, the reader, any place to land firmly. She's all comprehending from my estate. She views Earth's frail dilemma. Her eyes are not closed. She sees the suffering, right? The frail dilemma. And the frailness is about the uncertainty. You know, all of the things that threaten the head that I love, all of that stuff, you know, it's like we're fiddlers on the roof. Precarious. Life is very precarious. Like Epictetus, the Roman philosopher, said, when it comes to death, we all live in an unwalled city. She sees that frailty, but she has this strength. Scion of fused strength am I, all understanding. She's reaching deep, deep down inside of herself, not to be pushed by desire, by hatred, by all the things that it is so easy to be pushed and pulled by. And she will not be pinned down, nor this nor that contains me. So I think this is someone has mentioned what does threaten the head that I love mean? I think it means that if you're in a relationship, child, parent, lover, husband, wife, life is precarious, and so many things could cause pain to the other person or could eradicate the other person. So that's a threat. That's what I see as the threat. If anyone have any questions on that poem or comments? Okay, so let me continue.
Quick question.
Yes.
So, Harry, to me, she's talking as a daughter of slaves who is trying to stand that, she's made up of people that she doesn't know their history. She doesn't have a family tree, but she's willing to keep her eyes open, that she's got dignity and things like that. So it's interesting. I can really see when you talk about that poem, how you can make it much more into a Buddhist poem. But to me, reading it as an American about a Black woman at that time, it's really about her standing up for her freedom and her dignity and saying, you know, you white people, you don't know me, but, you know, you can't contain me. You can't say, you know, who was my father or who was my mother or whatever that kind of, that kind of relationship is that slaves had to deal with because they didn't know much about their history or have any control over themselves.
That's a wonderful point. And also you make a, you know, I talk about attachment. So, you know, you really have to keep me honest.
Well, it's fine. I love seeing the dual and interpretations.
Yeah. So I think, you know, I mean, she certainly, as far as I know, was not a Buddhist by any means. I'm also pointing how we do, you know, we take from these things what we take in a personal sense, according to our sensibility. And so what I brought out, you know, may have some relevance, but I think it's wonderful what you pointed out. And I think that's—
Well, and Harry, I think everything you said is right on target. I'm not at all challenging.
Okay, no, it's great, but that's—
No, not at all. I would like to ask you a quick question.
Sure.
When you read poetry, do you just always kind of look at it from a Buddhist point of view? Or, I mean, how do you choose these poems? Or—
Well,
it's fascinating to listen to you. It really is. It's totally opened my eyes. But I'm just wondering if you just read all your poetry that you love with a Buddhist perspective or how this works for you.
Well, I have to admit, I've been hit over the head hard by the Buddha. I just have to admit that. So it definitely sort of infuses, perfumes my perspective, and these poems that I picked out, particularly, I've seen things in them that I thought that I could highlight, you know, and my commentary is like putting dye on a slide, right? So, you know, so certain things get highlighted, and I think of what I'm doing now, and when I use this, is giving a Dharma talk. I'm not so much talking about poetry is poetry, but I'm talking about where things are pointing. So that's where I'm going with it.
I totally agree. That's exactly what you're doing. So
okay. All right. Well,
continue. I think we're all really enjoying this.
Oh, good, good. Yeah. Well, I'm having a great time. All right. So let's go to the next poem. Okay, back to Yeats. All right, so this is I've loved this poem forever, and it's so short and so rich, right? I'll read very short. I made my song a coat covered with embroideries out of old mythologies from heel to throat. But the fools caught it, wore it in the world's eyes as though they'd wrought it. Song, let them take it, for there's more enterprise in walking naked. So here's the thing. So, you know, once again, you know, we're put into, if not a dark room, a hazily lighted room, and we have to make out what's he talking about? What is a song? What does he mean by a song? And what does he mean by a coat? So once again, you know, this one might be a little bit harder on the Buddhist sense, because I think the song, I think here he's talking about himself as an artist, about his ability to express himself, about finding his voice, which is what poets do, and being true to himself. You know, it reminds me of Lu Xun, like considered the greatest writer in modern Chinese history, died in 1936. His last words were, "The job of a writer is to tell the truth. I have no soul, only a pen, and it is not for sale." Those are his last words. And so I think Yeats is dealing with something like that. In other words, he's becoming popular, he's becoming famous, and then he's embellishing things, maybe more than he has to. Maybe he's getting some response from people, and then he wants to please his public, his audience. So now he's coming up with arcane things. And, you know, if you read Yeats, his writing is quite extensive. He was into old mythologies and Irish folklore and all sorts of kind of mystical eschatology and all these wild things. So he's built this stuff up, you know, and covered everything from it. But people who don't understand him, you know, who are not interested in his message, you know, look what the public does. You know, if you look at Facebook or you go to YouTube and you see what people's comments are, you see how people respond to art, you know, and tell the artist what the artist meant or where to get off or how they failed or something like that. And so he sees this happen, and then rather than object to it, this is a process of letting go. So we're able to put a little Buddhism in. He's letting them take it. And then this enterprise of walking naked. Well, you know, once again, it's a stretch, but, you know, of like walking towards his true self nature, walking with no mental fabrications, no self agenda. Who knows? I really wouldn't go quite that far, given the nature of the poet and his times or whatever. But in some cases, I do want to show really marvelous poetry, and this I think is a case where you see how much is presented, how many questions are asked. How much is shown and how much is hidden in just very few lines. So it's really rather remarkable. Let's see. Any comment on this?
I have one.
Sure.
Oh,
hello.
It struck me as also like maybe the popularity is of his writing, his work, that people are sort of making a thing of it and kind of, I think we use the word reifying it, right? And
yes.
Sort of humbling himself at the same time he's rejecting that notion. That strikes me as connected to Buddhist practice.
Yeah, I think, no, thank you very much. I think that's really true. He is, yes, and maybe, and I think you're right, there probably was this draw. You know how, I remember Bob Dylan saying how fame really plays with your head. And Yeats was quite a celebrity in his time, and I think that's a very, very astute comment. Okay, let's go to another one.
Oh, there was one more question.
Oh, you have? Oh, sure, please. Did someone have a question?
Yes, Gita, can you?
Yes, I have a question. Thank you. This has been a really remarkable talk. I was wondering how Buddhists or how you might use poetry to kind of explore things deeper, maybe in a chant sense. So do you ever kind of knowingly go beyond what the poet may have meant, because it kind of served as a springboard for you to go deeper into your chant practice?
Well, in some ways, yes. I think I could take any poem that I've gone over and distill some of the kind of archetypal deep themes that are going on, and I can look into myself. And you know, once again, chan practice is a continual. You know, my personal definition of dukkha is you're fooling yourself. I'm fooling myself. That's what dukkha is. That I'm fooling myself into thinking that things are the way that I perceive them to be, and then you see through that. You have some insight, and then you come to another level. And yes, you've learned things, but then you're still fooling yourself in certain ways. And I imagine we keep fooling ourselves until the day that we reach enlightenment. Master Xiong Yan once said something that bodhisattvas keep breaking their vows. Even up until the 10th bhumi. And I can't imagine what that would be personally, but there's always something subtle that we're missing. And I see that my use of poetry and my interest in it all goes into the mix of self-examination and also world examination, of seeing how I'm perceiving and reacting, responding to what goes on around me.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay, so go to let's see where we go. All right, now this is interesting. This is a longer poem, but it can be read fairly quickly and. I'll make some interesting comments in light of what we've been doing. Now, this is a great poem by the Greek poet C.P. Kavafi, and it's called Ithaca. Now, Ithaca, just to give you a little background, that's where Odysseus finally was trying to get back after the Odyssey. So it's the it's your destination. Read Nirvana if you like. I'm not saying that's what it is, but okay. As you set out for Ithaca, hope your road is a long one, full of adventure, full of discovery. Laestrygonian, Cyclops, angry Poseidon, don't be afraid of them. You'll never find things like that on your way as long as you keep your thoughts raised high, as long as a rare excitement stirs your spirit and your body. Laestrygonian, Cyclops with wild Poseidon, you won't encounter them unless you bring them along inside your soul, unless your soul sets them up in front of you. Hope your road is a long one. May there be many summer mornings when, with what pleasure, what joy, you enter harbors you're seeing for the first time. May you stop at Phoenician trading stations to buy fine things, mother of pearl, coral, amber, an ebony sensual perfume of every kind, as many sensual perfumes as you can. And may you visit many Egyptian cities, to learn and go on learning from their scholars. Keep Ithaca always in your mind. Arriving there is what you're destined for, but don't hurry the journey at all. Better if it lasts for years, so you're old by the time you reach the island, wealthy with all you've gained on the way, not expecting Ithaca to make you rich. Ithaca gave you the marvelous journey. Without her, you wouldn't have set out. She has nothing left to give you now. And if you find her poor, Ithaca won't have fooled you. Wise as you will have become, so full of experience, you'll have understood by then what these Ithacas mean. So this is a really remarkable, rich poem. And to me, what's chon about it is it's opening up to all kinds of experience. Not getting waylaid. All of the things that are happening in this poem, all of the adventures, the dangers of the cyclops, right, and the wonderful perfumes, the knowledge that he can gain, all of these things he's experiencing. And, you know, it almost is like what Guo Gu says, you know, and exposing, not attaching to, such that once that he reaches Ithaca, Ithaca kind of disappears in a way. Whatever that iconic nature of it was, whatever the promise, the fantasy of Ithaca was, that's something that was important when he was starting out. But he changes, life changes, experience changes. And so now, at the end of his journey, returning after all of his travels, after the whole odyssey, and after all, that's what our lives are, in a way, a real odyssey. We don't know what we're going to encounter. We don't know where we'll end up, but we're trying to end up as whole and as happy and making other people as happy as we possibly can. That's probably kind of a chon Ithaca. But anyway, it's really a very rich, in my mind, a very fabulous poem. So I just want to see if anyone has any comments on that. Yeah, oh, you like it, Vic? Great. Let's see how I'm happy to go all night. I don't know. How are we doing, Sarah?
It's 10 minutes after 9. And you might want to start wrapping up now.
Okay, sure. We've been for this whole Dharma talk, we've been traveling to Ithaca, going through all of these different iterations and different viewpoints. Peering into the minds of others. That's one thing that poems let you do. Peering into very, very accomplished minds, very aware minds. Not that, you know, these Western poets didn't have a lot of suffering and didn't cause a lot of suffering. But, you know, this is kind of the nature of art. You know, like Stravinsky said, you know, in order to create, you have to destroy. Which is, you know, kind of a chon sentiment in a certain way. So, so my message is just to share this with you, show you how rich this is, and how much is really in chon practice, right? Which we might not be. So aware of if we are just looking at it as an abstraction. But once again, as we start to experience it, embody it, right, which is something also that Guo Gu says a lot. I mean, this can, you know, once again, we're always trying not to be distracted, not trying to get off onto tangents, but to the extent that we keep our heads and our minds about us, then it may help us with our wonderful and our propitious journey. So I wanted to thank everyone for listening.
Thank you very much, Harry.
Okay.
Thank you so much. And I hope we can invite you back again next year for. Yeah,
sure. This was a lot of fun. I really thank you so much. And thank you all for sharing this with me. It was really a pleasure.
Thank you, Harry.
Thank you for your teachings. Yeah. Thank you so much. Take care.
Sure.
You too. Thank you, Harry. Yeah.